17-year-old Floridian Tyler Hadley was so desperate to be cool that he decided to throw the party of the century to get everyone to love him. But Tyler had super strict parents, and he knew if they found out about the rager that they'd shut it down and he'd be punished. So instead of having to deal with that fate, he decided to slay his mom and dad and lock them in their bedroom before his guests arrive. The party went off without a hitch, but no one knew Tyler's parents were lifeless in the room next door until much, much later. Yeah, this story is wicked crazy. Grab your koozies and get ready. While you do that, I'm grabbing these jalapenos. All week long, Tyler was telling his friends that he was gonna throw a party at his house that Saturday. Now for the cashew cream cheese. The word got out to everyone from Tyler's high school, but when people found out about it, they were all like, "Who is Tyler?" From that, I'm sure you can guess, Tyler wasn't the most popular kid by any means. So maybe this party would be his ticket in with the cool kids. As Tyler was telling people about his summer bash, no one really believed him. He had never thrown a party before and his parents were super strict, so they didn't think it was actually gonna happen. Leading up to the shindig, people started asking Tyler if his big rager was really gonna go down. He said he was working on it, but most people took that as a no. But when July 16th of 2011 rolled around, aka Tyler's big day, the 17-year-old sent a Facebook message to his friend Antonio that said, "Sup, brah?"
Riveting.
Tyler went on to tell Antonio that he was still trying to have a party at his crib. Antonio asked Tyler if his parents were home, and he replied, "Nope," followed by the message, "Well, they're leaving soon." The typos and grammatical errors were abundant in these few messages. Later that afternoon, Tyler made it more official by writing a post on his Facebook wall that said, "Party at my crib, dot, 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 maybe."
Ah, playing hard to get, I see.
At 5 that night, Tyler started getting ready for his celebration. Now, most teen partiers get on their best outfits, take a few impromptu mirror pics, and maybe have a drink or two before going out. For me, it's the playlist while putting on my makeup. But Tyler's pregame looked much different. Everyone had been asking about his parents, and he kept reassuring people that his folks wouldn't be there. Even if he did get his parents out of the house, they would still hear about the party after the fact, so instead of dealing with the aftermath of that, he made sure they wouldn't hear a peep. That evening, Tyler popped a molly and was probably sweating because he planned to execute his parents. Before doing so, Tyler took his parents' cell phone, so you know he meant business. The teen then grabbed a hammer and approached his mom, who was doing some work on the family computer.
He struck her with the claw end of the hammer multiple times, and she obviously started screaming before taking her last breath. The word she screamed was, "Why?" Yeah, if my kid went after me like that, I'd be wondering why too.
Tyler's dad heard the scream, so he came out of his room to see what was going on. And that's when Tyler looked his dad straight in the eyes for a dramatic movie-style face-off. Tyler's dad couldn't come up with a more creative line, so he stole his wife's and said, "Why?" Tyler replied, "Why the f*** not?" and beat his 300-pound dad to the ground. But Tyler had no time to sit there and sulk on what he had done. No, silly, he had a party to throw. So after Tyler knew his mom and dad were gone for good, he locked their bodies in the master bedroom, spent 3 hours cleaning up their fluid, and got ready to welcome his first guest.
Yo, this dude is savage. I bet he didn't even cry about it either. At 8:15 that night, Tyler made another post that said, "Party at my house, HMU." And for those of you unfamiliar with 2011 text lingo, HMU stands for hit me up.
Tyler's friends still didn't buy it though and kept asking him what would happen if his rents rolled in. But in a horribly typed message with grammar and spelling errors galore, Tyler said, "They won't, trust me." And at 10 p.m., people started showing up at Tyler's house, but the party didn't really get started until everyone's favorite jock, Mike, showed up at 11:30 with his posse.
When Tyler first opened the door for Mike, he told him he didn't want anyone smoking inside because it was his parents' house.
Wait. So you're telling me this kid doesn't care about his parents to the point that he was willing to slay them for a party, but when it comes to getting smoke in their home, he gets all uptight? That makes absolutely no sense.
Well, it wasn't long until Tyler went back on his no smoking rule because he was trying to act all cool. As much as people doubted Tyler, his party was poppin'.
And after Mike showed up, people started filing in the house. Most of these people had no idea who Tyler was, and the sad part about it is they went to his school. And whether they knew Tyler or not, these partygoers had no issues showing up at his house for some free food and booze. At the peak of the party, there were about 100 teens inside, and they were all super sloppy and sweaty. They were playing beer pong, stealing snacks from the kitchen, shattering bottles on the floor, and putting out cigarettes on the carpet.
Even though it was messy AF, Tyler was the most nervous about the sound. He was worried someone in the neighborhood was going to call a noise complaint or something. And as sad as it would have been for the party to get shut down, I'm sure Tyler was more worried about his parents' corpses being discovered.
But even though his parents were out of sight, the smell of their rotting flesh was starting to make an appearance at the party. A few people made comments about the rank odor, and as a joke, one person even said it smelled like dead people, which Tyler was super on edge about.
Oh, he was definitely the embodiment of the Arthur Fist meme at that point. And as much as Tyler tried to clean up any evidence of what went down just a few hours earlier, some of the partygoers spotted a reddish-brown stain around the home computer. They all assumed it was from a beverage of sorts, so no one made a big deal about it. They were also probably way too messed up to care.
But even though everyone seemed to be having a good time, Tyler was freaking out on the inside. As people kept asking him where his parents were, he couldn't come up with a solid story. He told some people that they were in Georgia, and then switched that up to Orlando, but one of the best responses he gave to the "where are your parents" question was, "They don't live here. This is my house." Oh, really?
Please, tell me more about this house you own as a 17-year-old kid. Tyler also made a joke about slaying his parents to a couple of friends before the party had even started, and that evening, a few people alluded to that joke, which hit way different then. At around 12:30 a.m., the beer supply had been depleted, so Tyler asked one of his friends to drive him to a nearby gas station to get more. Dang, Tyler really is trying to impress these people.
From slaying his parents to going to get more drinks in the middle of a party, he's really going all out. But since Tyler was 17 at the time, he gave his older friend a wad of cash and asked him to go inside and secure the booze. The dude's girlfriend came along for the ride, and when she was left alone in the car with Tyler, he actually mentioned something about his father passing away. She didn't really know Tyler's past, so she just assumed it was a tragic accident or illness from way back when and brushed it off.
OMG, Tyler keeps scoring get-out-of-jail-free cards with all these super close calls. Like, no one was suspecting anything, and it's probably due to the fact that these people were royally intoxicated, but I'm still shook. Alright, so Tyler and his pals made it back home in time to rescue everyone from playing another round of water pong. And once the bottles were open, the party picked right back up. But on top of all the craziness that was going on in Tyler's house, some dude was apparently walking around with a bag of pills, selling them for a dollar each. There was also another hustler out there trying to make a couple of bucks from some good green. And at some point, a random kid took his shirt off and started running around with a mailbox over his head. Yeah, Tyler's party was a hit.
And one of Tyler's high school classmates even showed up at 12:45 in the morning just because someone had texted him that the party was the biggest thing ever. So naturally, he had to check it out. And in that moment, everything was worth it for Tyler. He was finally in with the crowd. Everyone knew who he was, and this time it was for something good.
The party continued on until about 2 a.m. when one of the kids stood up and made the announcement that there was another party going on down the street. Whether Tyler's was starting to get a bit boring or the partiers wanted a change of scenery, a huge, loud, and obnoxious group of people rushed out of the house to go to the other rager. Over a dozen cars peeled out of the neighborhood, swerving down the road, blasting Wiz Khalifa. But the house that was supposed to have this wicked rave was completely dark and silent. Some chick came outside in her PJs to see what was going on and told everyone there wasn't a party. Well, everyone was still itching to play some pong and dance around in their own sweat, so they popped back over to Tyler's pad.
When they came back, they were blaring music, revving their engines, and just being super noisy. A group of boys went over to Tyler's neighbor's front yard and started creeping in the window.
At that point, Tyler's neighbor had enough, so she called the cops. You know, I'm honestly surprised it took that long for someone to call the cops. 20 minutes after the call was placed, two officers rolled up to Tyler's crib. By the time they showed up, there were about 20 people there, so the party was pretty weak. Tyler told everyone to be quiet and go hide in his room while he answered the door. The cops told him there were some noise complaints, but Tyler was able to finesse the situation and get them to leave without a tiff.
And the party commenced. Tyler's friends started showing back up to the party, but Tyler was starting to act a little cray-cray. He was always checking the dorm windows, closing the blinds, and pacing through the house. When people told him how fun his get-together was, Tyler said, "I might have another one tomorrow night."
Then he told his friends he wanted to have fun before he left because he was going away for 60 years for doing something bad. You better watch out, Tyler. Looks like you might be slipping.
The celebration continued on through the wee hours of the morning. People came and went, and it must have gotten a little bit lame at like 4 in the morning because that's when Tyler made another Facebook post that said, "Party at my house again, HMU." Again? It never stopped. Also, posting about a party on Facebook is just asking for trouble.
But at 4:32 in the morning, the police showed up again, and this time they meant business. And who ratted them out other than Tyler's best friend, Michael? Oh, shit.
So sometime during the party that night, Tyler actually told Michael everything. Tyler pulled his bestie outside and told him he had whacked his parents.
Michael was all like, yeah, right. But as soon as he saw how serious Tyler was, he started to think the boy was telling the truth.
Oh my gosh, I can't imagine what that was like for Michael to find out his best friend just took out his parents and was so chill about it. Tyler convinced Michael that he was serious and told him there were plenty of signs around the house to prove it. He pointed out that both of his parents' cars were still home, and after that, he took Michael into the garage where he showed him a red-stained footprint. And for the grand finale, Tyler escorted Michael into the master bedroom where he revealed a messy scene of fluid-stained towels, random items thrown around the room, and of course, the bodies of his mom and dad.
If I were Michael, I would be running out of there so fast. But Michael must have not been too freaked out because he stuck around to hear the story of what happened. Or maybe he was freaked out, but his nosiness overpowered that. Yeah, I think that makes more sense. Tyler gushed about everything. He told Michael all about how he grabbed his parents' phones so they couldn't call for help, how he blasted Lil Boozy's song Feel Lucky, and got to work on his mom and dad. Before he grabbed the hammer, Tyler told Michael he took 3 pills of ecstasy because he was worried he wouldn't be able to do it sober.
After the deed was done, Tyler told Michael that he dragged their bodies to the master bedroom and buried them under a pile of broken dishes, shattered glass, pillowcases, Clorox wipes, books, a mop, a coffee table, red soap towels, and a canister of coffee grounds. You know, all the normal parent burying items.
And after the terrible cover-up, Tyler got to work on the house. And I'm gonna get to work on these breadcrumbs.
He told Michael that it took him 3 hours to clean everything up, and then he said he looked at his reflection after it was all said and done and laughed. He laughed? Tyler is not passing the vibe check right now.
Once Tyler finished his demented tale, Michael rushed out of the room, slammed the door, and kept looking over his shoulders. Even though he seemed terrified, Michael decided to stay at the party and even took a selfie with Tyler after the fact. I wonder if Michael was doing all of this to try and act casual so Tyler wouldn't go after him next.
But later on in the evening, Michael knew he couldn't keep a secret that big. So he called the Crime Stoppers hotline and filled them in on his insane bestie. And that's when the cops showed up for the second time. Before going up to the door, the officers ran the plates on the cars outside and determined that 2 of them belonged to Tyler's parents, which confirmed what Michael had told them. Once Tyler saw the officers parked outside, people at the party mentioned he was acting hella weird.
Friends said Tyler was pacing across the living room and talking to himself with a very disturbing look on his face. They said his eyes were huge and he never blinked. For some reason, that's one of the most terrifying elements of the whole story. People who don't blink really freak me out.
The bug-eyed Tyler then grabbed a stack of books from the bookshelf by the front door, took them to the back bedroom, and dumped them on the floor while saying something that sounded like gibberish. He took 2 more trips doing basically the same thing, and the only reason he stopped was because a police officer rang the doorbell. Tyler took a second to open the door, and when he did, he held his left hand behind his back. The officer then drew his weapon and ordered Tyler to put his hands up and step outside. The cops checked to see if Tyler had anything dangerous on him and then forced him to the ground where they put him in cuffs. And here's the best part. The police asked Tyler if there were any adults home and he said no.
Soon as Tyler knew it, the officers left him cuffed outside and headed for the house. That's when he told them, "You can't go in there, don't go in there." Too little too late, Tyler Boo. And it didn't take long for officials to find the bodies. More detectives showed up to conduct a thorough investigation of the scene. But there wasn't really much mystery about who had snuffed poor Blake and Mary Jo Hadley. There was a lot of mystery about why Tyler had done it.
After speaking with Tyler's friends, neighbors, and family members, including his 23-year-old brother, investigators started to piece together the motive.
Tyler was apparently really close with his mom and dad as a kid, but as he started to grow up, their relationship fell apart.
As a teen, Tyler started hanging out with all the stoners and rebels at his high school, where he got into smoking, drinking, and pill popping, and was no stranger to getting in fights. Tyler's parents weren't fond of his new lifestyle and put so much pressure on him to be someone he wasn't that he broke. A few months before the party, Tyler had gotten into a fight at a friend's house and was arrested for battery. This charge added to his juvenile record that already included burglary. Amazing!
And now for the paprika. While some of Tyler's friends believed his parents' strictness led him to perform the act, others claimed it was solely the substances he was on. Everyone said Tyler had downed a bunch of different tablets that day, so they thought he was so messed up that he just knocked out his parents. And when the police searched his house, they did find prescription meds for anxiety and depression, and the medication Tyler was on for depression can actually increase the risk of self-harm in young adults. Tyler even mentioned in a letter he wrote to his grandparents from jail that he wished he never started that prescription. "None of this would have ever happened," he said. I have a hard time believing that was the sole reason everything happened. Good try, though.
And no one else
really believe that claim either, because according to Michael, Tyler told him he had purposely waited for his brother to move out before he attacked his parents. Tyler also told an inmate in jail that he planned the event 3 weeks earlier. He even told him, "You should have come to the party. It was awesome." In 2014, Tyler was sentenced to 2 life terms in prison without parole. Since he was 17 at the time of the crime, he was unable to be sentenced to the ultimate punishment. In 2016, Tyler's sentencing was appealed because the lower court did not consider the correct alternative to a life sentence. In 2018, Tyler was resentenced to life in prison, but this time he was granted the possibility of parole. Oh, so maybe he can have another party. To this day, Tyler is still behind bars. He wrote a super dramatic letter to his grandparents where he was acting all guilty and regretful. He told his folks that he cries a lot in prison and prays every day for forgiveness. He's also written Michael and has since forgiven his bestie for snitching, although I'm not sure Michael was ever sorry he ratted Tyler out. Think about it. If Michael hadn't gone to the police, the truth was bound to come out sooner or later, and Michael probably would have been charged for helping Tyler cover it up. But after word got out about what was behind door number one in Tyler's house that night, a lot of people were really skeeved out. I mean, they were literally partying it up while Tyler's poor parents were slowly decomposing in the back room. Yo, I bet the kid who said it smelled bad was all like, "I knew it!" You know, stories like these always reassure me that I'm a pretty decent human. I haven't whacked my parents, ratted my best friend out to the police, or claimed a gruesome crime was worth the fun party and new Facebook friends. Yeah, I'd say I'm doing pretty well. But I'm still baffled by everything Tyler went through to try and be one of the cool kids. Did he slay his parents for the clout, because they were strict, or did it all stem from the meds he was on? Whew, this story is spicy, and so are these jalapeno poppers that I'm about to snack on. Thanks for watching.